I think the core thing about Bender that people that appeals to people the most is the fact that he can say absolutely anything that, you know, that he wants to. It's he can walking up the side of a building, like, you know, looking into a window and saying, "I get a room, you two," and the person in the room is like, "We're in a room. What, I lose some weight?" You know, it's just like one of those things where it's just, he can just get away. He gets away with just so, you know, short of murder, which I think he probably has gotten away with, but we just haven't found out about it yet. But he's just able to say what's on his mind. And I think that kind of appeals to him, you know, and he's not president. The thing about the voice is, it's a combination of three things. It's every drunk at the end of a bar that's just had one too many.
So it's kind of just you better just, I don't want to hear about your problems.
You know, it's that. It's Slim Pickens from Blazing Saddles. I don't know if you guys remember. What in the hell in the wide, wide world of sports is it going on? You know. Would you like some more beans, Mr. Taggart? Whoo, I'd say you boys have had enough. You know, that guy. And then when I was in university, I was in a pretty prestigious acting school at Rutgers University in New Jersey. And there was a guy, student, friend of mine, he runs a children's theater school in New Jersey, and it's great. And he's producing actors from it. My buddy named Ralph Colombino. He used to do a guy called, he had a character named Charlie the Sausage Guy. And all Charlie talked about was sausages. And so, sausages are fun to have, fun haul. You can have all kinds of sausages. You can have dry sausages, you can cut up like a, you know, charcuterie. And then you can have, you know, dry sausages, sweet sausages, Italian sweet sausages, Italian hot sausages. There's all kinds of sausages. The worst. You can have all good. And he would list off, he would keep going about sausages, and it killed me. And I would spur him on to just be like, "Oh, what do you think about sausages?" And he would just start going on about sausages. So the three things, those three voices, if you put them in a blender and mix them together, you get Bender. There it is. So, you know, that's pretty much it. So that's really where the voice comes from. Well, the catchphrase, "bite my shiny metal ass," is really the one that I think everybody really loves that one. But, you know, cheese it, you know, when Bender runs away, and gosh, there's others. Bender should not be allowed on TV. You know, the whole touching speech about how, you know, sometimes when, you know, you know Bender just gets all really sweet and wonderful, and then basically says to hit your kids, you know, just pummel them, really, which is kind of ridiculous. But everybody always has something to say, and you know, that's different. But mostly, I'm lucky because it's just straight up bite my shiny metal ass, and that gets him every time. It's just, you know, so it's kind of funny, yeah.
One of the nicest sounds in the entire world is Bender's "I'm up to no good" laugh.
Yeah. You know what? It's funny because when I would do that, I would always crack up David X. Cohen, which is great. When you can make the boss laugh, that's always awesome. But it was just basically just like a, it was really just like a tee hee 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 hee, like literally just like, and they just like, "Well, go for it," you know, and they, you know, sneaky laugh. They would, you know, it'd be in parentheses, sneaky laugh. So I would just, you know, I would think to myself, "Oh, sneaking around," just like, you know, just, yeah, you know, just being silly, you know. And then they had other stuff for me to do, like, you know, they would make me whistle as Bender, but they would also say, "You can't make it sound like any other song." So I had to make up, like, a song that didn't exist and yet not be musical about it, but whistle. So it's like, well, what kind of narrow path are you sending me? So that's why when you hear Bender whistle, and that's all it was. But that became that. Then they were just like, oh, kind of hum along. And we want you to hum along now, but don't be musical. And that's when I started going, do da dee lo dee lo do boo dee la skoo la bee da ba bee dee lo dee do dee da ba do le voo. And that was called the Bender Strut. And they would just go Bender Strut, and they would let me just do it because I came up with it. And what's great is that I got into the composers union because I wrote those. That was me that wrote those songs. So every time they get played, I get a check from ASCAP, which is like, you know, the songwriters union in the United States. I think it's here too as well. But yeah, I got a check from, you know, Bender Strut, you know, Bender Whistle. Like, yeah, a couple hundred bucks. I'm like, yeah, all right, man. Yeah, I was a songwriter. So yeah, it's pretty funny. It's interesting because he was, I mean, at the introduction of the show, he was such a narcissist and just was so self-centered. And I think him having Fry and their growing friendship, you know, throughout the show and the series, I think that changed him a lot and kind of, you know. And you know, that's one of those things about a show that gets to have the life that it had. You know, the characters will change and you know, over time and you know, grow. And I think Bender grew a lot, as far as that's concerned, about, you know, caring about other people and especially orphans. And, you know, he fell in love a bunch of times. But his growing friendship with Fry, I think, has everything to do with it. And you know, I mean, his funkometer changed, you know, his funkometer got a little more funkier as the show went on, you know, put a little more soul in it. Yeah. You know, a little, that kind of thing, you know, like, you know, when he's walking out of the courtroom, you know, after getting busted for pimping, you know, just, we love you, Bender. Shut up, baby. I know it. You know, that stuff. And that's really kind of just like, oh yeah, baby. And you know, when he's fooling around with the femputer and Amazon women on the moon, and, you know, got to fool around with Bea Arthur, you know, one of the Golden Girls, which is ridiculous. But yeah, I mean, you know, I was actually recording with Bea Arthur and telling her, oh yeah, baby, give me some of that. And you don't really normally get to do that with Bea Arthur. So that's kind of, you know, it's very funny. But yeah, Bender, yeah, his narcissism, yeah, it was totally... totally narcissistic, but it starts to fade as the show grows. So, I mean, I love playing Bender, but my favorite character from Futurama is Zoidberg. Why not Zoidberg? I'm not hearing a no. Just one of my, I mean, it was so fun. Well, when we did the show, everybody loved Zoidberg. And in, you know, and Billy doing the voice of Zoidberg was just absolutely brilliant, and I would just mimic him constantly just to try and get some dueling Zoidbergs going, you know, la 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 la, like, oh, are you gonna eat that sandwich, you know, but yeah, he's hands down one of my favorites. I love Zoidberg. But as far as like recurring character, like characters that would come back and forth, there was Mayor Poopenmeyer always cracked me up. And he had this kind of a voice where he was talking. It was Dave Herman that did it, who also plays Scruffy, who's also one of my favorites.
Scruffy, the janitor.
But Dave Herman, you know who he is. David Herman is Michael Bolton in Office Space. That actor, he's also on like Bob's Burgers and King of the Hill. He's been doing. He was a Mad TV cast member, as was Phil Lamar, who was, you know, who was also in the show as Hermes. And the original Leela was Nicole Sullivan, who was on Mad TV, and they replaced her with Katie. Interesting trivia. There you go. All the Fry memes are so awesome. I love that. Those really, really kill me. And Billy originally had no idea what the memes meant or what they were or how culturally significant that they were at the time, and now he is all over it like white on rice. It's so funny. Like, he's just like, he's like, wow, man, I love these memes. This is amazing. But no, Fry's memes are definitely my favorite. That's always awesome. That's always awesome.
And do you have favorite versions of some of the most popular ones, like the Shut Up and Take My Money or the Not Sure If ones?
The not sure if ones are those are money. Those are absolutely, and those are the ones that he couldn't figure out. Like, he didn't understand. So, but then when he figured it out, he was like, oh, I get it. Now I understand. And yeah, those are the ones that are the best. Those are the ones that are the best. So, my favorite.
So you're saying legitimately Fry was not sure if when he was thinking about the not sure if.
Oh, yeah. No, that's it. No, literally. Yeah, absolutely. Yes. Absolutely.
The show got cancelled when it came back. Did you notice any change to the way it was written?
No, none. None. It made me angry. I'll tell you this. It made me angry when fans would say, well, it's different. It's not the same. It's, you know, the writing is different and all that. That's all BS. It's all nonsense. Same writers. In fact, if there were new writers, they were the writing assistants that became writers on the show, which is true, but everybody had the pedigree. Everybody had the Simpsons pedigree, which is interesting about the new show that we're doing, Disenchantment, for Netflix. A ton of Simpsons and Futurama alumni, and you know, when you work with people like that, they have it's a well-oiled machine. So, you know, Futurama was basically Matt's baby when he did it, and it was easy. For me, like, there's just the clockwork that at which the show worked. It was amazing, and it was a solid formula from the get go. Because they'd already done all the homework with The Simpsons, so the framework was just perfectly laid out for us.
If Bender could have anyone as his next romance, who would you bring?
Ooh, if we were still doing Futurama and Bender had a shot at, well, who would I want to? Wow, I'd want to have my wife doing it. So I don't get in trouble. Yeah, that's a good one, right? Dodged a bullet on that one, man. That's really fun. Lucy Liu. Lucy Liu, I had in a jar. My wife did an episode of Elementary with her, and she was just my husband says hello from inside. You know, you were inside his body, and she was just like, "What? Wait a minute, Bender, if you try," she'd be like, "Oh my God, that was so much fun." But yeah, I'm being safe. Same, my wife, Kate Miller. That's done.
Any favorite fictional robots apart from Bender?
I don't know. I always like the old Lost in Space with the danger, Will Robinson, danger. Liked him. God, what other robots? Watch a lot of Westworld. Those are. Oof. That's some crazy. Those are some crazy robots. Gee, well, who else? Johnny Sacco and his flying robot. You guys remember that? I'm aging all of you. Yeah.
You did just make that one up.
Woo! No, that's not true. Johnny Sacco and his flying robot. It was this show. It was an animated show. It was a live action show from like the late 50s, early 60s from Japan. And it was this big. Google that, man. Johnny Sacco and his flying robot. I loved that show when I was growing up as a kid. It was great. He shot missiles from his hands. He would fly around on the robot. It was awesome. I can't even explain it. It was too much. Yeah, I like the robot from Johnny Sacco and his flying robot. Yeah, I totally remember that. Boom, right there, it came back.
Given everything's better if you put more Bender in it, if you could take any TV show and, however inappropriate, add Bender to, as a character to it.
Oh, wow. Oh, okay. How about... okay. Let's put Bender in Westworld. Why not?
Death to all humans.
Yeah, exactly. He'd kill everybody. He wouldn't even know. He'd kill all the other the hosts. He'd kill everybody. He'd be like, I don't know who's who. You're all gonna die, baby. You know, just a slaughter fest. Yeah, I'd love that. That'd be great. That'd be really funny. Or The Walking Dead. Why not? You know, just like, ooh. So you're dead already? Wait, I don't get it. You're a real meat bag, you know? Sure, Bender could fit in anywhere. Sure, absolutely. Soap opera. What, Telemundo? You can get a telenovela, you know? It's just like, ooh, ah, yo soy un macho, hermano. Stupid. When will we get to see another dose of Bender? You know, that's a good question because we did that mobile game recently, and in order to promote it, we did basically a radio show of Futurama, and it was interesting because it cost less to do because there was no animation involved. But it was longer than a normal episode. So if we do another mobile game, which I'm sure can happen, we may do another, you know, a radio show to promote the game again. So I don't know. I haven't been approached for anything, but with this show and the amount of times it's been canceled, I don't even know. You whatever. Anything can happen. So I'm fingers crossed. Knock on wood. Carry a rabbit's foot, do whatever you got to do, because that's really it. I get a lot of people that come up to me at conventions that are like, they say, you know, I was totally into Futurama, now I have kids, and the kids are watching Adventure Time, and they kind of turn each other on to each show. Like, you know, the kids grew up hearing Futurama in, you know, when they're watching, you know, the show, and it's going, you know, this isn't for you guys, but they're, you know, kids are top of the stairs listening, laughing, and Adventure Time, you know, the kids are watching it, and then the parents are in the kitchen or in the other room going, why does that sound so, wow, that's really neat. It's funny, you know, you do kid stuff, and then you do adult stuff, and I mean, and that's really just, you know, that's one of the joys about this job is that you can do so many different things. You know, there's different kinds of characters that you can play, it's a free for all. If you're lucky to get the work. And you know, Adventure Time was such a trippy, weird show. I mean, yeah, it's for kids, but it's for everybody. It's one of those things. And I think that's kind of generally what appeals to everyone about animation is that, you know, it appeals to the kid in you. So anybody from, you know, 1 to 92 can get their kicks watching an animated show or a film or what have you. I think it's just kind of universal that people are drawn to it. It's something that they watch as children and they can watch as adults. And you know, there's all sorts of stuff. I mean, you know, Under the Red Hood, like, I was the Joker in that. And, you know, he beats Robin to within an inch of his life with a crowbar. And then, you know, lets him be and then blows up the building. Like, you know, I don't want kids watching that, but... But just the same, it's just like, you know, in another thing, you know, I'm Jake the dog and I'm hiding in Finn's pocket and farting, you know. So it's just it's It's all over the place. It's no, actually, just for trivia's sake, I did all the fart noises myself for Jake the dog. So just, you know, it's a point of pride for me.
Adventure Time in the past tense. Now you've already shot the last season.
Oh, we did. We did. We finished it. It's already been done. They're airing it this year.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was. It's funny because I've been. I'm on the record as saying I had no idea what the show was about.
Yeah,
within the first couple of seasons, and then it was explained to me beautifully by Tom Kenny, who was the Ice King and also SpongeBob SquarePants. He's brilliant. He said, John, it's this generation's Yellow Submarine, and I went. Then that's what it is. And the Land of Ooh is just, it's just so all over the place. It's a vast universe. And it turned out to be one of the joys of my life. Last episode we recorded, I can't say what happens, but I could barely get through it. Emotionally, and I've never really had that happen to me before, except singing Christmas songs for Penguins of Madagascar. It's embarrassing. Christmas songs, just, oh God, look at that. This is really rough. You know, it's interesting. Jake's journey. I can tell you this, the character grew on me. The universe of Ooh was difficult for me to navigate, trying to figure it out. But Jake himself was okay. That was easy. The themes, I think. The adult sort of themes in a children's cartoon, I don't know. I think sometimes you just got to break the ice, and people kind of were a little, upset or kind of shaken, taken aback, but I don't know. The show itself. Well, I don't think it was really supposed to be like a kiddie show. It was kind of this world that anybody could kind of watch, and enjoy, And I've been to so many conventions and met so many fans of the show, and they're all ages. So I think that any kind of heavy themed episodes or through lines through multiple episodes, I think they were handled well by us, but I'm sure that there were kids that watched that had many questions, or at least were just they realized it. I think in general, if you talk down to children, they know it. But if you bring kids into the fold, and you talk to them, and you encourage them to relate to what's happening, they get it. So, and I don't think we ever talked down to kids. We weren't like, hey, we're gonna do a show, and no, they in my experience, the kids don't like that. They want to laugh at the same time the adults do. They want to be emotional. They're keyed into that. They're much more pure and less jaded than we are. So I don't know. I think Jake grew in the show, just like Bender grew in the show. I think that's the thing. If you have the room to move, to grow, then you do. And that's also what propels the stories that we tell.
Do you feel a bit of Bender slipped into Jake?
I think a bit of me slipped into both of them. You know what I mean? Not in the biblical sense or anything like that. But, you know, I think it's impossible to not have something, you know, something of your own, you know, be a part of a character. And I'm sure, you know, and Bender is that, you know, he's up in here. He's sort of in the back of my, like, his voice, it bounces off the back of my skull and then back into my mouth. And Jake is really, Jake is just my natural voice, but with a hug around it. You know, just like a nice warm blanket. And yeah, there's always going to be something that you can hear. I mean, nobody's perfect. We try to be, but it's and the more you try, the more you kind of you put yourself in a corner. But yeah, there's a little bit of everybody in everybody, I guess. Greatest voice actor is Mel Blanc. Period. He wrote the book. He's the master. Right now, I'd say the best in the biz, Frank Welker, Billy West, Maurice LaMarche, I mean, we got some guys here that are top notch, Jim Cummings and Jess Harnell, you know, but it all depends on what you like. Subjective. So, I mean, you know, some people might just be like, John DiMaggio, you're sick of that guy. I don't know. You know, I mean, who knows? But thank you for the compliment, but I don't know.
A particularly comedic duo in Lego Star Wars, The Pre-Maker Adventures. And I wondered what your experience was working on that project.
Oh, Star Wars?
Yeah.
That was with Danny Jacobs.
Yeah.
Me and Danny Jacobs playing the Bash and Ram. Well, the interesting thing about that is the guys that wrote and produced that were guys that worked on Penguins of Madagascar, and Danny and I worked on Penguins of Madagascar together. He was he took over the voice of King Julian, and I was Rico, the regurgitating penguin, which was actually a lot of fun because I would try and make the voice director barf in the studio because I had to make a lot of those noises. And if you're, you know, if you're doing vomit noises, you can get people to it's that thing where, you know, if you just, oh my God. And people, if they look at you, they start, forget it. It's a downhill spiral from there. But that was a lot of fun working with Danny's a great guy, and it was totally a lot of fun doing that. It was a blast, and I work with Danny in a heartbeat. He's great, and the guys that did the show, they're fantastic.
Disenchantment, for those of you who don't know, coming out August 17th, Netflix. It's gonna be awesome. Matt is brilliant, and the people that write the show are brilliant. They can be really dirty and filthy without being dirty and filthy. And it's a better way to tell a joke. I unfortunately am not that smart, so I go to the gutter, you know, immediately. And they paint a very beautiful picture of the gutter, which is really something. You know what I mean? Disenchantment is gonna be great. I don't know if I'm allowed to say this or not, but I don't think it's gonna matter. I'm the voice of the king. I play the king, and you'll see it. It's really, really, really funny. It's a great cast, and it's all Simpsons and Futurama alumni. It's just stacked with great people in it, and I just can't wait. I wish I could tell you all about it, just like everything you need to know, but it's up to you to find out. You got to watch and do the, you know, do the. But I'm really, really excited about it. Basically, I mean, like, it's as if the Simpsons fornicated with Game of Thrones. It's really, it's fantastic. It's really, really, it's just right on time. It's just arriving at the perfect time. And I don't even know if I'm supposed to say anything, Except that it's accepted. No, I haven't really signed anything, but I'm not going to tell anybody like what the names of the characters are. I'm playing the king or a king, and the show is basically, you know, if the Simpsons fornicated with Game of Thrones, and that's really, I mean, it's really. You know, I mean, and that's my way of saying it. I mean, I don't know. I don't know if that's Netflix approved or not. But, you know, hopefully, I won't get canned because of it. Because you can't say that. You know, well, yeah, you can. Because it's kind of true. You know, but it's really it's timely and it's really, 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 really funny. And you know, even though it's on Netflix. It's still, it's not filthy. It's not just, you know, it's not like, hey, Matt Groening wants to say the F word. You know, it's not, it doesn't have any, no, it's not that. But it's brilliant. They can be filthy without being filthy. They get it. They know how to do it.
Doing it long,
and exactly. So that's the thing. And it's really cool. And it's really funny and it looks great. Like, you know, that's the one thing, like, that's different from doing an actual television show where you're on a set and you're acting the lines in front of a camera as opposed to doing an animated show, because you don't know what it looks like until you're in post-production and you come in to do, like, ADR, possibly, you know, and I've seen this stuff and it's just great. It's just really great. And Matt's character design is just so, it's great. You know, it's just fantastic. So I can't wait for everybody to see it.
His previous work, would we recognize it? Or is it?
Oh, no, it's very clear. And you could totally recognize it. And people, like, I saw something on Twitter. God, Twitter is just, oh, man. The people are just like, oh, it looks like The Simpsons. It's just like, yeah, it's the same guy it's the same guy drawing it. Like, what are you thinking? Like, it's, I don't know. People sometimes ding-dongs, but whatever. It's all good. It's a funny show, and I'm just happy to be a part of it.